excuse me, as I welcome you to the word portion of worship from Daleville Christian Church. Let me begin with God's word as we read them in the book of Psalms, a word that simply means songs. In the book of Psalms, we read God as our refuge and strength, a very present help in time of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, we will not fear. In our day and age, we know more about tsunamis, that they are caused by earthquakes that affect the ocean floor. They didn't know that in Bible times, and yet we understand these Bible words very well. Even if the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, but the Bible quickly adds, we will not fear. Tsunamis are certainly destructive and bring many things to an end. But the Bible says, even if the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, even if our life changes like a tsunami within it, we won't be afraid because God is our help. God wants us to know that God will help us. It's said about the God I serve that God is a very present help in time of trouble, and as I have pointed out, any kind of trouble. We have an affirmation of our faith, which we share each week, this one from Titus in the second chapter. For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good. The reading of God's word for today is from the letter of the apostle to the churches in and around the Greek city of Ephesus. In the fourth chapter, verses 26 through 32. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading of his holy word. Yes, forgive yourself. If you type that topic, forgiving yourself, and mention Bible, Google will give you almost 4 million pages you can look at, and most writers, speakers, bloggers, and websites will tell you about forgiving yourself. Some will even say 7 Bible verses to help you forgive yourself, 25 Bible verses to help you forgive yourself, then even 42 Bible verses about forgiving yourself. 4 million websites can't be wrong, can they? Not only should we forgive ourselves, but clearly thousands of people need help in forgiving themselves. We will get to some of those Bible verses. But then, of course, I could find a website, some preacher who says, you don't need to forgive yourself. I wondered how this guy could claim that. You know, I can get pretty angry with myself, And I can be unforgiving with regard to me. So I certainly feel a need to forgive myself. So I remember what he said, and another author said something similar. They said, the Bible doesn't mention forgiving yourself. One writer said, Jesus never taught that. Okay, but be careful with that line of arguing. The Bible does talk about slavery, and the Bible doesn't talk about automobiles. We all decided to outlaw slavery, and we decided to adopt automobiles. Were we wrong to do that? I don't think so. The Bible doesn't say to outlaw slavery, but we did. The Bible says nothing about automobiles, and we have had them and used them every day for the last 120 years. One preacher, Robert Schuller, remember him? Televangelist, Our Power, Crystal Cathedral. He started that church in a drive-in movie theater. People worshiped in their cars. Who remembers what a drive-in movie theater is? No, the words forgive yourself are not in the Bible as such, but the Bible says we should, Colossians 3:13, bearing with one another and forgiving each other. Whoever has a complaint against anyone, whoever has a grievance against anyone, just as the Lord forgave you, so also should you. So, can I ask, have you not complained about yourself, to yourself? Have you not had a grievance against yourself? Didn't you ever say, well, state your name, that was a stupid thing to do? Or say to yourself, I shouldn't have done that. The Apostle Paul's advice to churches who have an offender among them in 2 Corinthians, so that on the contrary, you should rather forgive and comfort him, otherwise such a one might be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. We talked about this excessive sorrow at Ash Wednesday service. There was a popular song in 1999, I think you have to be in a certain mood or live a certain lifestyle to really like this song, but it won Billboard Music Awards Award for Modern Rock Track of the year 1999. So the song is over 20 years old, but listen to these lyrics. The title of the song is My Own Worst Enemy. Can we forget about the things I said when I was drunk? I didn't mean to call you that. I can't remember what was said or what you threw at me. Please tell me why my car is in the front yard and I'm sleeping with my clothes on. I came in through the window last night and you're long gone, gone. It's no surprise to me, I am my own worst enemy. Because every now and then I kick the stuffing out of me. The smoke alarm is going off, there's a cigarette still burning. Please tell me why my car is in the front yard and I'm sleeping with my clothes on. I came in through the window last night and you're long gone, gone. Please tell me why my car is in the front yard, etc. It's no surprise to me, I am my own worst enemy. Some of us can relate to this song without getting drunk. We've done things we shouldn't have done. We said things we shouldn't have said, or we made decisions, and the person we hurt most by our actions and our decisions was ourselves. There was another popular song a couple of years ago, had this line in it. It said, I've received more grace than I deserved, meaning from other people. Again, wrong turns, bad decisions. All our efforts put in the wrong direction. And other people can be more forgiving toward us than we are to ourselves. every addict, if and when they recover, discovers that they hurt themselves most. That there were in their recent past possibilities and opportunities and help available from other people, and the addict realizes in recovery that they always chose their addiction as their most important relationship. And they put all their efforts into maintaining a relationship with their addiction of choice, whatever they're addicted to. They were, until they can recover, they were their own worst enemy. But you don't have to be an addict to make poor decisions that cause you pain. People go hiking alone in rough country. People go hiking with a friend and don't take a compass. They don't take enough water. They don't have a solar battery charger if their phone loses power. Or they don't take their phone, people get lost. Or there's a fall while on their hike. There is no medical care. They can't walk back. Some people have died in these circumstances. It's quite a price to pay for a poor decision, a bad decision, a wrong turn. The only person responsible for those are you, ourselves. There are psychological types of people with regard to anger, which we began this message with. We can be angry at circumstances. We can be angry with people. Some people often blame someone else. It's always the other guy's fault. And some of us blame ourselves. I should have known. I should have known better. I should have thought of that. And people who blame others or they blame themselves can get very angry. As I said, the Apostle Paul mentioned a sinner being overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. In his book, Suicide, the Forever Decision, Dr. Paul Quinette has a chapter on anger turned on ourselves. Even though one of his patients told the doctor, "I'm too depressed to be angry." That's a warning, because as soon as a person has enough energy, they might proceed with their suicide plan. That's why there's often a warning with antidepressants. You will feel that you're able to do what you plan to do, but before the medication, you couldn't. Often people who acted depressed suddenly seem better, and the loved ones then hear of their suicide. Well, the person felt better because they had resolved to follow up on their suicidal thinking. They were going to act, and so they acted and felt better inside. They had made their decision to suicide. They would become a statistic. Sometimes those suicides begin with anger inside. At ourselves. Sometimes those who become angry are afraid they might lose control of themselves and resort to violence. And sometimes it's violence against themselves. Dr. Quinn had asked this question: what if I told you that just because you're angry, you don't have the right to go around breaking things, calling people names, hitting people, or hurting yourself? What if I told you that just because you are mad doesn't mean you have to blow your stack and lose control of yourself? The answer to these questions may appear obvious to us, but the answers are not obvious on the streets of our big cities, where anger plus a handgun results in someone getting shot, and sometimes too oftentimes someone is killed. Or the answer is not obvious to people who get angry while driving in traffic. And an angry person, road rage, decides to use 2 tons of steel to teach someone else a lesson. And if you're that angry with yourself, Apostle Paul suggests that unforgiveness can overwhelm. So what to do? It's time to give serious consideration to forgiving ourselves. So Jesus followers, and any pagans listening, number one, as a Christian, you want to understand that our Lord stands ready to forgive you. Anything and everything in Jesus' name. Pagans, same answer. Our Lord stands ready to forgive you anything and everything in Jesus' name. And remember, as you desire to forgive yourself, pray for it. As you desire to forgive yourself, consider what it was you were truly responsible for. Maybe the whole problem or the sets of problems are not all your fault. And maybe all of the problems you caused are not all your fault. Find out. Think about it. Pray about it. And is there anything you can do about it? Then your forgiveness can be focused. Some things don't require forgiveness. There may be some things that you did which can be excused and should be. Forgiveness is not needed, but stand ready to forgive what needs forgiveness. As the Apostle Paul wrote, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. Then realize that our Lord can redeem your anger. You may want to remain angry. Let it work something good within you. Martin Luther King Jr. worked for civil rights. Why? Because he was angry at discrimination in America, an America that promised equality. Martin Luther King Jr. channeled his anger into working for justice for all. My wife and I were watching a program where a person's bad decision resulted in the death of another person. It wasn't that person's bad decision directly that caused it, but it happened. But that person redeemed the bad result of the other man's death by dedicating himself to helping other people. Anger can be channeled to work for good. A friend of mine recently said, with Jesus, no pain goes unused for good. An IBM engineer's young teen son suicided in 2003. Since then, the engineer has spoken to hundreds of schools about bullying, prevention, and suicide prevention. He decided he needed to do that full time, gave up his engineering job to do something he was never trained to do, speak to crowds of teenagers. He said when he first spoke, he decided to speak from his heart. That man turned his pain, his anger, and his love for his son, his suicided son, into preventing any other parent from having to go through what he had to go through. You can read his book, Ryan's Story, Love Beyond Belief. In the first pages, the author described getting the news of his son's death, and one of his first thoughts was, "It's all my fault." He felt that way because they had had a good talk, the father and his son, just a week earlier. The author, the dad, thought that his son just needed a pep talk, and his son had told his dad he didn't want to go back to the therapist. That man, John Halligan, turned his pain, his anger, and his love for his suicided son into preventing any other parent from having to go through what he had to go through. The man had to find a way to forgive himself. Forgiveness, even in the worst experiences, is possible through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Forgiving ourselves is also possible because we have been forgiven through our Lord. If you still need forgiveness, if you still need to forgive yourself for something past, work on it. Pray about it. Pray for it. If you need to forgive yourself later today or tomorrow of this week, remember, it can be done. And move in that direction. I would share with you that as we are transformed to be more like our Lord Jesus, areas we want to see change in now may not be areas that our Lord wants to work on right now. We will need to continue in prayer with patience. Let me close with these verses from God's Word. We looked at Jesus' words last week, Matthew 7:14. For if you forgive other people when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. The basis for forgiving ourselves is the kindness and compassion of our God in Christ Jesus. All who are in Jesus are freed from condemnation, Romans 8:1, and freed to love, Galatians 5:13. We are meant to display the mercies of God as sinners forgiven of their sins, 1 Timothy 1. Extending grace and kindness to oneself and others is the transformation of God in those who have received His grace and kindness. Such gentleness is only possible for us all because Jesus has set us free from the power of sin, the tyranny of self-rule, the oppression of evil, Galatians 5.